Before 2014, it had been suspected that the Sun likely originally formed along with other stars in a huge cloud of dust and gas, eventually forming an open star cluster. But the star-forming region and the stars it created, including the Sun, dispersed over time and have now spread out through the galaxy. But one thing is notable. If the Sun and our early solar system had the right materials for a planet to arise, spawn life, and ultimately a civilization, then any siblings of the Sun might have been similarly endowed with the right initial conditions for life to arise. There is no guarantee of this with star systems in general. In fact, it's thought that regions poor in phosphorus, for example, might preclude life from arising, leading to galactic dead zones. So naturally, finding siblings of the Sun that formed from the same cloud of materials would be of great interest to SETI as potential targets to check for signals or bio or technosignatures. But in 2014, it was announced that the first known sibling of the Sun had been discovered. It's the star HD162826, and, as it turns out, it's located a lot closer than a sibling was expected to be. At a distance of only 110 light-years, this star is close in galactic terms, which certainly makes searching for SETI signals easier. But more, it's also not that dissimilar from the Sun. HD162826 is a type F8V star, and it's debated as to whether any or all of the F-class stars could support habitable zones. The two problems present with this kind of star is that they have shorter lives than the Sun, but still billions of years, but also have higher brightness and radiation. If a habitable zone could exist around these stars, it would be further out than it is here. But one wild card here is that we don't really know how fast evolution can really kick in on a world where life initially arose. The problem here is a potential great filter, the jump from prokaryotic life to eukaryotic life on Earth. This took an exceedingly long time, about 1.8 billion years. The filter being that if it took that long, it may be that that kind of jump is very rare, and life in the universe is predominantly very simple as a result. But, though seemingly less likely, it could also turn out that Earth was a late bloomer, and that the jump, if applicable to the biology of an exoplanet, might happen faster, allowing for the evolution of life and perhaps intelligence much quicker on an exoplanet. We just don't know. The other issue is radiation. Any exoplanet around this star would need an atmosphere, such as one with a sufficient ozone layer, that can shield it from the very high levels of ultraviolet light that these stars produce. This is less of a problem if it were an ocean world, or life was adapted to caves or lava tubes that could protect them. And there's also some thinking that ultraviolet light, in the right amounts, might actually help life to evolve. Past that, HD162826 starts looking better. Astronomers know it's a sibling of the Sun because of its chemical composition. It's eerily similar to the Sun, much the same way that human siblings tend to resemble each other. But one thing stands out. It's a few percent more metal-rich than the Sun, suggesting that it once probably had lots of material for planet formation, perhaps even more than the Sun did, which makes rocky planets around this star very possible, though none have yet been detected. It's highly speculative, but possible, that even the molecular precursors of life, or even life itself, if it arose early enough, might have transferred around to these solar siblings when they were closer. While highly unlikely, that's very early in the solar system's history, there are probably lots of chances for something like that to have maybe happened. There could be thousands of other stellar siblings of the Sun yet to be discovered. The star is only the first. And they too may be excellent candidates to look for exoplanets that might have biosignatures and just maybe technosignatures. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently wishing I could eye the microbes suspiciously without a microscope. I've had my incidents with them, having been attacked hundreds of times over the course of my life. But I also like yogurt, so it's a trade-off of sorts, but I'm not sure I'm comfortable with them ruling the galaxy. And be sure to check out and subscribe to my new channel, Event Horizon, link below and in the end screens. The first full-length show appears this coming week, September 20th, where my guest will be Dr. Abraham Loeb of Harvard University for a discussion of, you guessed it, astrobiology. And we're going to do a book giveaway over there, some of the only signed copies of my books in existence in this amazing universe in which we live.